Welcome. You're tuned to the Urban Affairs program. It's time to get up for Urban Perspectives with your host, Pete Rhodes.
Welcome. You're watching Urban Perspectives. I'm your host, Pete Rhodes. On this episode, we'll spotlight a new health facility in the Cayman Islands designed to provide high quality and affordable health care worldwide. And we'll discuss the launch of a new care facility in North Minneapolis for seniors and youth. And finally, we'll review Minneapolis' hosting of the 40th National Association of Black Journalists Convention with the honorary chair. Thank you for joining us on this edition of Urban Perspectives. My first guest is the former director of the tourism for Cayman Islands and the current marketing director of Health City Cayman Islands. He has a BA in business administration and marketing from Stetson University in Florida and is the recipient of the Young Cayman Leadership Award. And his mission, of course, is to bring Health City Cayman Islands a marketing strategy for a world-class facility that attracts local, regional, and international patients. Here's a look at the project, Health City Cayman Islands. Thanks, Shomari, for joining us here on Urban Perspectives. Looks like a fantastic project that's already in workings and looks, of course, great in the Cayman Islands. So let's talk a little bit about the project, if we may. As the former director of tourism, you know all about the Cayman Islands.
I do.
Give us a little perspective on the three islands, where the location is for the new health facility, and what makes it special coming there to the Cayman Islands.
Well, yeah, you're right. Being a former director of tourism gives me the perfect perspective to speak about the Cayman Islands. We're three islands that are located just off the coast from Miami, so one hour flight, we like to say close to home, far from expected.
Exactly.
And from any U.S. gateway, it's about 4 to 5 hours from all the major cities, so we're right there. Cayman Islands is unique in that, yes, we have beautiful beaches, we have beautiful sand, beautiful infrastructure, just like many other Caribbean countries, but we have what we like to call Cayman kind. So the safety factor, the fact that it's a family destination, the fact that when you come there, you feel as if you're at home, which is backed up in 2012 TripAdvisor. We were the number one Caribbean country.
Exactly, yeah.
And number 20 in the world, the only Caribbean country ranked in the top 20. So when our TripAdvisor persons are saying that we're that good, then we can, you know, then take a pat on the back and say, yes, Cayman Islands is a great place to be.
Yeah, and where is Health City located in, among the three islands?
So Health City is actually in Grand Cayman, the largest of the islands. So we have about 55,000 people, and of the 52,000 live on Grand Cayman. So that's really the largest, and Health City is located there.
And what is the concept, Shomari, for the project that makes it such a fantastic new program there for the Cayman Island residents as well as worldwide?
And what's interesting about the project is that Mother Teresa's physician, Dr. Shetty, is the visionary behind the project. And he partnered with a large conglomerate healthcare system in the US, Ascension Health, to come together in the Cayman Islands to put together this facility that wants to give the highest quality possible in regards to your healthcare needs from a cardiac perspective, orthopedic, so you know, hips, knees, joints, and make it at a very affordable cost, because across the world, only 20% of the world has access or can afford, you know, super specialty types of services like cardiac care and, you know, bypass surgeries and holes in the heart and the such. And he wants it to be 90% in our lifetime. And he has 30 hospitals throughout India, and this is the first in the Western Hemisphere, and using the protocols which delivers the highest quality, which is a testament that we've gotten our Joint Commission International accreditation in 1 year.
That's big.
That's big.
That shows that that hospital and that project is accredited across the world.
Yes, it is. It is. And JCO, which is the accreditation system in the U.S. for the top hospitals, JCI is their international arm. And we got that within a year to show you the quality. And he wants to reduce the cost so that everybody would be able to afford it.
Now, how, Shomari, do they reduce the costs? Mm-hmm. You know, we're in America where healthcare is skyrocketing, seems like every day in every area and procedure. How do they manage, to keep the costs affordable?
Well, what happens is that there's a vision behind the project, and the fact that Mother Teresa told him that the reason he's here on earth is to fix and to help fix so that more people can gain access. So by having that vision, everybody who is employed within the actual facility is a salaried employee, whereas a lot of times that you'll have physicians in the U.S. that are consultants that will come and go to different facilities. By having salaried employees, they believe in all the protocols and procedures that Dr. Shetty and the Narayana team has actually put into Health City, mm-hmm. which helps to streamline the process and also to reduce costs. So for instance, you'll have infection rates, and the higher the infection rate, the higher the cost, because patients need to stay longer, there are higher readmittance rates, and by having these vigorous protocols, our infection rates are less than 1%, which is in the tops in the world.
What can individuals expect in terms of quality of healthcare and services there at Health City, Cayman Islands?
Yeah, so we have many services, but the top three, definitely anything to do with your heart, mm-hmm. whether you have a pacemaker, whether you need to have stents, whether you need a bypass, we can take care of it, as well as we have done the first two artificial hearts, LVADs, in the Caribbean. So for those that need the super specialty type of service, we're able to do that. And of course, as the population ages and there are a lot of people who need new hips, new knees, new shoulders, we take care of that. Spine surgery is also big, neurosurgery. So we have a full remit, but those are the major surgeries.
Well, now, Shomari, thank you so very much for coming here. We will talk more about this. I'm sure we'll be hearing more about this. And safe trip and travels back to the Cayman Islands.
You should be coming with me.
I should. Hopefully soon.
Yes, thank you.
Shomari Scott here. Weekly on Urban Perspectives, we present Shining Stars, highlighting people, places, and events that contribute to the vibrancy of the urban community. Our shining star this week is an up-and-coming vocalist and musically talented family he comes from. His father was a celebrated trumpet player, his mother a renowned vocalist. He's a self-taught drummer who discovered that his vocal and writing talents may be his key to stardom. Meet our shining star, Lawrence Miles.
My name is Lawrence Miles. I'm a vocalist and a songwriter. I sing gospel music. Now I'm a part of the group Darnell Davis and the Remnant. My dad played the trumpet in church. My mom was the church singer, and she was also the children's choir director. So she forced me to step up and take some of the leads. Growing up in a Christian home, believing that gospel is it's a music that gives hope to the hopeless. You can look throughout the history of time, of throughout slavery, and how gospel music is really what kept people together and kept them pushing forward. Gospel music is even the root of blues and rock and roll and jazz, and all these different things all come from gospel music. So for me to have the ability to sing gospel and encourage others, that's my heart's passion. The gospel music here locally it's very important. When you look at the different things that are going on, not just in our city, but even across the nation, gospel gives hope. It speaks of hope. It ministers hope to people to know that there is that light at the end of the tunnel. Tragedies are commonplace, all kinds of diseases. People are slipping away. Economy's down, people don't get enough pay. But as for me, all I can say is thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. That's my favorite song. No matter where we've been, no matter what we've gone through, we can always say thank you for what he's allowed us to have. So that's my favorite song. My name is Lawrence Miles, and I'm a singer and songwriter here in the Twin Cities, and you're watching Urban Perspectives.
Thanks, Lawrence. We appreciate that. And when we return, we'll meet the founder and CEO of Olu Center, a licensed care facility in North Minneapolis, specializing in senior and youth care. And next, we'll talk with her, Gloria Freeman, right here on Urban Perspectives. The Twin Cities Mobile Jazz Project launched its first season at the Dakota Jazz Club in downtown Minneapolis. Patterned after jazz legend Billy Taylor's Jazzmobile of Harlem, the Twin Cities Mobile Jazz Project mission is to promote self-expression in a safe and diverse form for all ages and nationalities. This summer, parents and youth are encouraged to join the Twin Cities Mobile Jazz Project band. For more information, visit the Twin Cities Mobile Jazz Project.org.
You're still at it. You still have all the right moves. Still embracing the moment. Still have that sense of adventure. Welcome to UCare. We've been expecting you.
Learn more about our Medicare plans at ucareplans.org. UCare, healthcare that starts with you.
Back to Urban Perspectives. In 1999, my next guest founded Olu's Home, a licensed care organization providing residential and in-home services to elderly persons and those with developmental disabilities. Today, the company operates 9 group homes in Minneapolis, employing 50 people. The group now includes the recent addition of Olu's Center. Here's a look at the new facility.
Walk through and see.
No matter the age of the
seniors and kids, come along and join in.
Finally, a place where our children and seniors can interact and learn from one another. Olu Center is opening a new childcare and senior day program.
For more information or to
register. That's Olu's, send them together.
Hey! It was like a mess,
yes.
And now it's beautiful.
Yeah.
And
yes.
Thank you so much, Gloria, for joining us here on the show to talk about that fantastic center. We came over to take a look, and of course, we're familiar with the old way being there, but once you go inside those doors, you've done a fantastic job with creating an environment, I'm sure, that's going to be warm and comforting to those individuals who have an opportunity to be a part of it. So let's start out and ask you, what makes the home special, and what prompted you to start this whole odyssey?
Oh, thank you for your compliments, too. I appreciate that. And you're talking about Olu Center or
yeah,
Olu
Center.
Home?
Yeah.
Okay, Olu Center. I had owned Olu's Home for a number of years. And a few years back, we decided that we wanted to grow our business.
Mm-hmm.
And we decided that during that time, my mother was dying.
Okay.
And I had the birth of a new granddaughter around the same time, a couple years before she died. And the way that they interacted was fabulous. What children bring to people, adults like me, seniors,
yes.
Older people. And so we started doing some research and came up with the idea of doing an intergenerational day program.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then what we also do is we make sure that the environment is a clean environment, that their meals are non-preservatives, they're all natural, made from scratch.
Mm-hmm.
We're very holistic thinking, and so that was the reason for us coming up with this idea of being a very holistic center from
start to finish.
From
yeah.
start to finish.
Yeah. Now, what is Olu's Homes, the previous, what are their goals in providing service to elderly as well?
Mm-hmm.
Our population is of course, getting older, mm-hmm. and you have started that operation a while back. What is its goals?
Olu's Home was started in 1999, and our goal was always believed in the principles that we all have a right to live a whole fulfilled life.
Mm-hmm.
And we base it on those principles. No matter what type of support you need or what type of support you need, you still have the right mm-hmm. to give back.
Mm-hmm.
You have the right to do as much as you can in life. And so based on those principles, we've been able to provide a really fabulous service with our adults that are severely mentally ill. And then we branched out into the senior program.
Yeah, that's been very successful. Mm-hmm. Now, as we look at the development of the new facility, Olu Center, what services are specifically offered again, and how important is this, Gloria, to the Northside community?
Right. Our service, we provide child care service from infant through school age, and we also provide senior program, and that's why we're called the intergenerational program, mm-hmm. because they come together throughout the day and they support one another. They give back to each other, right. and it's a phenomenal feeling. And so what I feel and what I hope that we bring to North Minneapolis is just another fabulous way of growing our community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's so important, especially as we see so many disheartening news coming out of that area, but there's so many great things happening in North
right.
Minneapolis too, and you're contributing immensely to that. So I want to ask, what type of individuals, how are you of individuals' requirements for them coming to Olu Center?
Well, like I said, we're a day program for children, so if you need child care service, we're the ones to provide that service. If you have an elderly parent that needs some place to go and spend some time, we're that provider. We focus on, it's just not a place for them to go mm-hmm. and play games, which they do that. And they also support our children there. But it's also some serious business for mm-hmm. our seniors. Mm-hmm. They're there to write their memoirs. They're there to, we support them in writing their wills and their testaments. So it's a place where we're saying that we want to support you.
And a lot of things can get done. Now, you have been a successful business person. What advice would you give women to be successful moving through this business world?
I would say that get a group of good people that are good to you, that are mentors, that become mentors for you. I would say believe in yourself. Mm-hmm. And I know sometimes we have that little inner voice that tells us positive things, but sometimes it outweighs the positive and tells us negative things.
Yeah.
So you gotta get that out. Remind yourself that you are great and that you can do whatever you put your mind to.
Well, you've done a fantastic job Thank with you. It. Keep on doing it. We support what you're doing in North Minneapolis, and thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right. Next on Urban Perspectives, meet the honorary chair of the 40th Annual National Association of Black Journalists Convention, held right here in Minneapolis. We'll discuss the organization and his extensive background in HR and organizational management. Meet Bill Wells next on Urban Perspectives.
There's a place you can go, no matter the age or the skin that shows.
We're here for you.
A place where our children and seniors can interact and learn from one another. Olu Center is opening a new child care and senior day program.
For more information or to register, call 612-824-1142.
That's Olu's Center, where different generations come together.
Hey! Here we go. What?
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Because kids in foster care don't need perfection. They need you.
Everything about you. Yeah, you are perfect to me.
The Twin Cities Mobile Jazz Project launched its first season at the Dakota Jazz Club in downtown Minneapolis. Patterned after jazz legend Billy Taylor's Jazzmobile of Harlem, the Twin Cities Mobile Jazz Project mission is to promote self-expression in a safe and diverse form for all ages and nationalities. This summer, parents and youth are encouraged to join the Twin Cities Mobile Jazz Project Band. For more information, visit the Twin Cities Mobile Jazz Project.org. Thank you for joining us. Our next guest is President and CEO of W. Wells & Associates Management Consulting Company. The company creates a vision of advancing culture change and transformation for workforce and workplace strategies for business. Bill holds an MBA degree with a major in marketing and is the former chairman of the National MBA Association. He's a member of Kappa Alpha Psi fraternity and, of course, the Minnesota Monitors. We welcome to Urban Perspectives, Bill Wells. How are you doing, Bill?
Good morning, Pete. How are you?
We share the monitors together.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we should have had our pens on.
That's true. That's true.
But I'm so glad you are able to be here today. We go back a ways, and you've been doing some fantastic work here. Of course, we've been celebrating a week-long of events with the 40th NABJ. Yeah. As the honorary chair, Bill, what has the convention brought to Minneapolis, and what were your duties in helping to create this connection?
Right. Well, you know, a couple of key things. Economically, it brings in a lot of revenue to the Twin Cities, particularly here to Minneapolis and the greater Twin Cities, just from all the people that are here and all the businesses that benefit from serving meals and hosting, you know, happy hours and things like that. But importantly, it brings to the Twin Cities a large contingent of very highly qualified, some of the top names in the business.
For sure.
And I think that's impressive, and that's important. It's an intangible benefit, but it's one that allows the community to see that much of the negative stuff that we see on TV.
Yes.
It's not true.
Yeah.
And I tell people all the time, it's a lie.
Yeah.
Don't believe it.
Yeah. Well, seeing all the journalists and, as you said, some of the prime individuals from all the various networks. I sat on a panel with people from CNBC Black Enterprise and others. Fantastic. And the students that are here, just super.
The students are amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, that's really what it's about, too. The NABJ is creating a pipeline of future talent. And these are the people that we're going to be seeing on TV, as anchors and as news reporters. By the way, I also met someone from BBC here the other night.
Oh.
So we've got a global contingency here as well. It's not just local.
That's for sure. Now, as the former chairman of the National MBA Association, how does the organization that you were chair of help to develop the diverse professionals from within our communities as well?
Well, the primary focus that the National Black MBA has is focuses on education, education first and always.
Yeah.
We have to have that. So we promote people going to college, focusing in the field of business. And so we do it at the undergraduate level, we do it at the graduate level, MBAs. Obviously, we do it at the doctoral level. But probably one of the most exciting things we have now is what's called the Leaders of Tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
It's a program that's been going on for about 25 years. So we capture high school students that I say are at promise. They may not be fulfilling their academic potential, but they have the ability. And it's a year-long ongoing program. It starts with kids in ninth grade.
Fantastic.
All the way through, and we get them scholarships. We do a week-long boot camp. So that's getting into our local communities, tapping into high school students.
Very, very important. Now, what inspired you, Bill, to make your career in diversity and HR as a part of your lifelong mission?
Well, I'll be honest. I didn't plan it that way. as you know, when I came here and when we met, I had left AT&T.
Yes.
And I had been working in New York for about 13 years. And my career was really focused on business. So I've done a lot of different things in business, I saw my career continuing to be in the business sector. And literally through a chance meeting, I guess it wasn't really chance, it was divine.
Divinely
it was
driven.
Part of the plan,
of course.
I just didn't know it. and I was invited into joining HR because the company was going through a transformation. And I had a lot of training in that area.
Yeah.
And I was invited in, and it started from there. It was an individual. And as you say, it was the rest is history.
Now, why is the workforce diversity, you would be as an expert in it, so important in today's business climate?
Well, you know, a lot of people get confused and they think that diversity is about social change and what have you. It's not.
Mm-hmm.
Diversity and inclusion is really about employee engagement. It's a business strategy.
Mm-hmm.
So it's about growing a business, having a workforce that really is reflective of the marketplace.
Uh-huh.
And in the country, we've seen the browning of America. We see, you know, the demographics in our population changing dramatically.
Indeed.
A lot of immigrants, a lot of communities growing. And so it's a business proposition. Mm-hmm. And companies, they do one thing. They sell products, they sell services.
Right.
And the marketplace is becoming highly diversified.
Now, when we close, as we close, what advice would you give to individuals, companies in particular, for one thing they need to do to bring forth some inclusion into their company?
You're asking me the question about the secret sauce.
The
secret sauce? Well, it's really about leadership.
Yeah.
It's about leadership and vision, accountability, and then commitment.
Yeah.
And without the senior leadership really having a vision, it just really won't get traction. It'll become a program that lasts for a moment.
Mm-hmm.
It's a flavor of the day.
Yeah.
But leadership is about the business and about, you know, meeting the bottom line. So tying this into and aligning it to the business strategy is the crucial solution.
My man, Bill Wells,
right.
so glad to know you and that you continue to work as hard as you do in our communities overall to create the platforms of diversity and inclusion, which is so important.
Well, you keep doing what you're doing. That's why we do this.
All right.
Okay. Thank
Fantastic.
You, Pete.
All right. Bill Wells. Thank you for watching Urban Perspectives. I'd like to thank our guest and Shining Star, and of course you, for getting up with Urban Perspectives. And remember, you can visit our website at urbanperspectives.tv for information on our guests and where you can find links to previous broadcasts. And please help us grow by liking our Facebook page. And remember, there are so many amazing people and positive stories in our cities. Watch for them right here on Urban Perspectives. Now enjoy the photos of the week featuring the annual Curry Fest. I'm Pete Rhodes, and I'll see you next week.